Oh, I thought we talked about this.
I told you I can handle it. Let me get the phone.
Dr. Cornish, I got the plasma.
We can cancel that. Thanks for all your help.
I don't sound like that.
You do a little. Son cava sous le bras, en pleine nonchalance, un peintre en bâtiment, de moyenne importance, en ce jour de congé, traîne son anatomie, un sourire irradiant, sa tête de lundi, chaque jour son visage.
Of What the Hell Happened to Them, starring yours truly, Patrick Scale, and JoJo the Jet Plane. Woo. And then, of course, we have our special guest. Bob has returned to us again.
Yeah, you just can't keep that door locked, can you?
and Joe, what movie are we doing this week?
The week of, which I just want to say, every time I go on Netflix to watch this movie over and over again because I keep falling asleep to it, I have to actually go into the search option and look it up because it's never anywhere on my Netflix queue. Or anything.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm like, why can't it just be in, like, the, oh, you've been watching this, or, like, you previously watched this. No, it's never in anything.
The UI has changed, Jeff. It's just what it is. But that's okay, because The Week Of doesn't really deserve a space on the front page anyway.
Oh, so. Hard disagree.
Oh, I am going to be the worst
here. Let's thank Lev for being on the audio boards. Thank you, Lev, the audio maven that we are craving. And then today's sponsor is the Honda CR-V. You don't have a choice. You have to drive one. All right. Now, Joe, can you give us a summary for The Week Of?
This movie is a week in the life of a family whose daughter and, like, their the Chris Rock's son, right?
Yep.
They're getting married, and it's just a bunch of crazy family stuff's happening. That's how I felt about it.
That's how you felt the summary.
I just want to talk about Uncle Seymour. Uncle Seymour is the star of this movie.
I think that might be one of the few things we could agree on.
So Sandler, when he is breaking, like, trying to break down that wheelchair, and he's just like, just really trying to push it into the trunk, I'm like, this is just some great physical comedy that we have not had from Sandler in so fucking long. And I'm like, this is what I've been craving. I love this movie right now. And then it just falls apart from there, but, like,
Scale.
Yes.
Oh. I can't wait to fight Joe head-to-head, one-on-one,
yeah.
Cage match. This is... I am so anti this movie. It is the anti-Sandler movie.
No, no.
In its own bizarre right. I'm sorry to have interrupted you, but...
No, I agree. If it falls apart, I just really like the whole physical thing with the wheelchair, which is like 5 minutes long. Because I watched this movie in really weird parts, because I watched like 10 minutes of this right before I went to go see First Reformed.
One's going to know what you're talking about, Joe.
Yes, because that movie's going to be nominated for Best Picture next year.
No, it's not. It's
yes.
going to be quickly forgotten.
No, I love this movie.
As a taxi driver in a church.
Does not qualify.
No, so does the rest of, like, film. Like,
will be forgotten when all the November and December movies come out, Joe.
There are
enough other early movies
that are coming out right now that are going to be Oscar fodder besides. There was one that I just saw recently coming up, not to stray us too far.
It's okay.
I think it's called Eighth Grade, and you follow an eighth grade girl
great.
Who is
the
going
Bo
to go
Burnham
through
movie.
All the...
Oh, yeah.
It's a Bo Burnham movie?
Yeah.
Ooh, that just sold it for me.
Right?
Yeah.
I don't know if I'm strong enough to watch that movie.
No one's strong enough, but that's why you have to watch it.
I don't think I could go back.
Yeah, no, it's
we all have to
everybody.
Go back.
No.
We're all going to cry and die.
No, I have Fully Cooley. I don't need to go back to middle school. It's okay.
No, Fully Cooley.
That's it.
I just feel like the fact that they were willing to put acne on a child in a Hollywood movie.
The fact that they cast an overweight, quote-unquote, blonde girl dealing with all this stuff, I am just super about.
Yeah.
I'm really glad to see a realistic child in this film.
Yeah, I'm just hard in. Like, this movie looks fantastic.
Yes, so we can all agree that that's probably going to beat out First Reform.
No, well,
yes.
Hold up.
Yes.
But let's get back to the task on hand. We're gonna do a lot of these side strays.
No, yeah, no one cares, but the demographics do not care about First Reformed.
I just really enjoyed it.
Okay.
I hope that's your secret baby.
Listen, the second half of the movie works.
The old women that were sitting next to us in that theater.
Who had no idea what was going on.
They had no idea what they were getting into.
Yeah.
And when he... Like,
yeah. I don't know why they wanted to see that movie.
When he starts wrapping himself up in the barbed wire at the end, their horrified expressions were just like, ah! Like, they started, like, screaming a little bit.
Well, you know, if you like torture porn, but you know, us will easily beat that out.
It fit the movie.
I don't know if it did, but it worked kind of.
I mean, and then it's just yeah. But I just love the ending where it just like was circling around
that,
them.
Yeah. All right. So like, can we talk about the week of?
Please. Well,
I mean, this. Yeah. I mean, with when we start out the movie with Chris Rock.
Yeah.
In yeah. surgery, and it's just like, oh, this isn't like a super, like, this is more of like a just slapstick comedy movie, because he already makes a small dick joke, and he's taking the hand, like, because he's got bloody gloves, he's doing heart surgery, he's got bloody gloves, and he takes the patient's hand, and he's trying to, like, tap the phone, because he can't do it with the gloves on, and I'm just like, oh, this is gonna be a slapstick movie. No, it's not. After we get past the wheelchair part, I feel like this movie just goes into, like, oh, we're just going to do, like, family bits. Like, what's going on with families?
I'm
going
to have to get into just a quick little bit of editing issue that I really did not care for with the beginning of the movie. There's a really chintzy title transition sequence right at the beginning where it just goes the week of. It kind of, like, fades in and fades out, like something that we use in Final Cut. No bang up job there, no animation thing, or, you know, even just a simple title card. You just fade, you know, cut to a black card with the week of, cut back in. Simple thing. No, we fade in and out like this is a straight to DVD movie. Something that we don't need for Sandler's career right now.
It is a straight to DVD movie.
it's certainly. It is the straight to DVD Sandler movie to bookend with Going Overboard. I'm just saying, it's that bad.
You think this is the end of his career?
I think it's a great way to bookend his career.
Well, let me tell you something, baby, because he's in Hotel Transylvania 3 this summer. He's going to make $100 million.
It's going to make $500 million.
Well, I'm talking about in the U.S.
Yeah, but there's also going to be a bunch of, like, internet porn of the characters, so, you know, weigh that out. Anyway, I found, like, it was really frustrating to hear this super capable but super negligent good guy doctor just literally within the first 5 seconds of watching Chris Rock's character seemingly going against this angry Long Island family man that is in at least based on the beginning, a seemingly dying relationship with his frustrating Rachel Dratch wife.
Finally, Rachel Dratch gets a prominent role in one of Adam Sandler's movies.
This yeah, Rachel so Dratch does deserve more work. I just don't think that this was a role that I could like her in. She's perfect to do the role that Sandler wants. Yes. So I'm happy that she delivered for what he wanted. I hate Sandler's love of these character archetypes. It's just super frustrating. Elder abuse right off the bat. Like, just, hey, let's just make the old guy take a bunch of hits and wait for him to die due to, well, we'll get into that later, I guess, because we still haven't actually completed the summary, but...
Yeah, Joe's not very good at that.
No, that's...
He's not.
That's the...
The joke?
That I don't know how to say.
I mean, it'd be nice if you could do one.
Is this a bit? Have you been, like, spoiling the entirety of the show for a bit that we don't know about?
No, I'm just really... It's all in your head. Movies. You should have listened to us trying to go through a top 25 of the new century, because Pat was like, what's the summary of this movie? I'm like, ugh.
And it's like a 30-minute opus. And then he's got 24 more to do. And I got to sit through them.
I'm really bad at it. I just don't know.
So stay tuned for that later episode.
Oh.
Okay, so let's get into it. Robert Smigel, this is his directorial debut.
This is his directorial debut. I was curious about that. I saw his name on the title, the end credits, and I was like, why is TV Funhouse making this movie, and why can't it be funnier? It is not translating.
Yeah, very, very frequent collaborator with Adam Sandler. I think they, like, write all their movies together.
I'm not surprised. I'm certainly not.
He was Walter the Dentist in Punch Drunk Love. I'm just going through his filmography right now.
Sure, okay. Well, you enjoy your IMDb moment there, but there's super choppy cuts for the comedy that happens in, like, the first 20 minutes of this movie. Like, just jump cut to jump cut. Like, that really awkward scenario of trying to take one of Sandler's clients around while trying to carry his uncle around, trying to overcompensate, like... It's just more of a try-hard character than I need to see in the course of the first 20 minutes of the movie. We get it. He's a nice guy. And he's a nice guy that doesn't like to let people down. That's great. And? Oh, that's it? Good. I'm glad I've got 1.25 dimensions of this character. That's just me, though.
Patrick, what'd you think of when we finally get to see another Sandler, like, buddy show up, Mr. Steve Buscemi? He's sitting on the couch.
Yep.
He's Seymour's caretaker.
Son.
It's okay.
Yeah, because they're cousins.
Wow, wow, you've not paid attention to this movie.
Really?
Three times I watched this movie.
And while we're seeing the validity of this movie, because if it's a Sandler movie that you can't stay awake for...
Yeah, no, it's not good. I just really like that bit with Seymour. Seymour is the breakout star of this movie. Give this guy, like, a Best Acting Award. Like,
isn't that the spit guy?
Yeah.
What?
He looks like he's lost a lot of weight.
Wait, the spit guy?
The spit guy. From...
Wait, no, wait.
Is it?
Hold up.
I think it is.
The spit guy?
There's a guy in...
Jim Barone. Oh, he's got nothing.
No?
This is his first movie.
It sounded like the guy with the spit guy.
No, it
did. Yes, it did.
Who is the spit guy?
He's 77 years old.
So a spit guy could be old.
Okay, wait.
Scale, you're not answering my question.
Okay, Joe, what's the guy's name?
This is not the same guy, because this says James L. Barone is a former Democratic member of the Kansas Senate. This could not be the same guy.
It is not.
They got him for this movie? Wow. Joe, tell him the spit guy.
Wait, from The Waterboy?
Yeah.
Oh, well, right, we don't talk about the spit guy.
All right, then the guy who was in all the other Adam Sandler movies.
The guy with the weird eyes?
Yeah. No, not the guy with the weird eyes. The guy with the voice who was in Community.
You can never remember the gym teacher?
No.
What's his name? Oh, you messed me up now.
Yeah.
Okay, but you're talking about the guy who he eventually does nude billiards with. I got it.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. He's in a lot of Adam Sandler movies.
You said nude billiards.
So I thought it sounded like he was this guy in this movie.
No,
I
know that's who you're not talking him about at all.
It sounded like him.
No.
No, yes. I know. It's to be fair, it looks like if you would put some sort of like prosthetics on him to make
I just,
him look older.
Yeah, I just thought that the years had not been kind to him.
No, that's not
he's
him.
He's getting up there. But
he's good.
He's the guy that played replaced Jim Varney for Slinky Dog in the more recent Toy Stories. From like two or three forward, yeah, he's been Slinky Dog. Anyway, why is Ted Cruz the child? Why is Ted Cruz, why is former Republican president nominee Ted Cruz the child of Adam Sandler in this movie?
I don't know what he's talking about.
So, the child who has the baseball game towards, like, the end of the second act.
You're saying he's the Zodiac Killer?
Yes, I'm saying that this child is Ted Cruz, the Zodiac Killer. Don't take that seriously, internet memes, guys, please. But, so this child is part of this weird... almost Mandela effect thing that's going on, that ever since Ted Cruz started being more prominent of a national figure, people have been seeing a lot of lookalikes of Ted Cruz around in various ages and genders. Like, we've seen plenty of young girl and old woman Ted Cruzes. We've seen child Ted Cruzes, baby Ted Cruzes. And, like, I'm starting to wonder if there's some sort of, like, alien invasion based off of this person that we know is Ted Cruz.
Like a Men in Black
scenario. I think it's like a video game and just some background characters use the same.
But yeah, if you
shapes.
Try to put this kid next to a picture of Ted Cruz side by side on your screen, you will see there's some sort of a weird resemblance. Who knows? Maybe Ted Cruz's dad got around. I don't know.
Ooh, like Genghis Khan.
Genghis Khan. As played by John Wayne. But yeah, no, Rachel Dratch does a great job of being grating in this movie.
She's just great. Well, I'll just give a round of applause for Rachel Dratch. she's just always solid in everything she's in.
I liked her in Hurricane Bianca, and if you get a chance, that's a good side movie to check out. Stars one of my favorite drag queens.
Does this look like me?
No, you do not look like Adam Sandler. No, just
don't
because
try you to make that face.
Just because you're trying to put your teeth over your lip and then jut out your chin does it makes you look even less like Adam Sandler. But good job, good A for effort, C for attempt. But where's the comedy in this movie? Seriously, guys.
When he's trying to get that wheelchair into the back of the trunk. And then and then the wheelchair breaks down. And he's like, "Oh, now you break down on me!" And he's just, I mean, it's great. It's
so
it's
somebody being irritated with a prop is comedy.
He's got great prop work, and I think
if that had been done with different framing with a different camera back in like the late 80s, early 90s, you probably could have got me on it. You could have sold me, but with the like pseudo person in a parking lot style camera work, it just reads more like Adam Sandler is actively getting frustrated, not in role with a prop, and it doesn't feel like comedy. Oh, it just feels like a person.
If you're trying to, I think you've gotten old and cynical.
Yeah, come on.
I'm gonna defend this movie.
Scale, I guarantee you.
I was defending this movie because here was my thought in the first 10 minutes of this movie.
Oh yeah.
It was, holy crap, somebody's directing this movie.
Yes,
isn't a fair thing to say because most of his movies, nobody directs it, so my bar is set so low.
Mm-hmm.
And this is what I think I realized during this movie, the full extent of my Stockholm Syndrome, if this was like the first Adam Sandler movie I had seen in 20 years, I would have been like, I don't want to watch this. But having watched 47 Adam Sandler movies, I like this movie.
So I see your struggle right now.
I like the weird editing. I like the nonstop people coming in. I like the oh shucks good guy trying to make everybody happy. I don't know why. I can't even say if it works. But in the context of Adam Sandler's filmography, it works.
I'm saying, hold on.
Somebody tried to direct this movie and throw background jokes in there and get the most out of his blocking and put people in the frame in weird places to just get you off your guard. And it's refreshing.
Say your thing before I jump in on this.
So, after my second watch through, I told Patrick yesterday, I'm like, Adam Sandler's doing something weird with his voice that he's been doing lately. And I was like, I'm not really into it. My third watch, I'm into this voice. I love this voice now. He's doing his character that he's been kind of like doing subtly, like putting it. He kind of did a little Meyerowitz stories a little bit, but he like turned up the notch.
I like Adam Sandler being this pathetic.
Yes,
who's got no power but wants to have all power.
When he goes into the bathroom with Seymour, I mean, I really love the beginning of this movie.
I like when the guy runs after him in the van saying Seymour has to go. Seymour's awake.
You know, it's great that you like one of his family members in a role because there are so many family members in this movie. There's at least two Smigel kids that are in the baseball scene.
Sandler is... Sandler has made one of these Netflix movies each year, and he's got four more to do. So he's going to have eight years of Netflix movies in a row. So I feel like it's the only way he could spend time with his children.
I'm going to make a quick sidestep before I make another comment involving this family thing.
That's okay.
We're living in a bizarro world where you're playing the I like this guy when normally away from this microphone you hate everything.
Listen, I'm broken. Adam Sandler's broken me.
Yeah, I can tell.
50 movies of Adam Sandler is broken.
And as a subset of this statement, his voice in this for this character, this role that he's made, is just a less caricature role of a character that he's done in a bunch of his stand-up CDs and his shows.
Fine.
So, like, it's nice to see it as a more humanized character, but this is not a new
The argument is they could just take more time to make these movies, but for some reason they're not. And so for a movie that's... for a movie that's been a year, I go, all right, well, it was nice to see somebody try, because...
This movie's been in 2 months.
Going from the ridiculous six to this... It's the Netflix movies have just at least gotten better, and somebody's given a crap. So
that's fair. But if you wanted to see a movie that was made in a year, I think you should watch Real Love, done by Patrick Skahill. You can find that on Amazon Prime.
Don't compare this to Real Love.
You don't know.
I don't know.
People decide. The people need to like decide.
Real Love. It's not at all like Real Love.
No. I think we need to jump on this for a half a second.
Real
Love is the story about a person who is having a struggle and is relying on his kooky but realistic cast of people around him to try and make his way in life.
Go for it, Bob.
I think that there's a strong comparison between The Week Of and Real Love, and they both revolve around a wedding. So it's a nice, like, this is a good double feature.
Well, I think people need Sandler, to if you want to
put this at the bridle right now.
If you want to see what movie compares to yours, you can find Real Love on Amazon Prime if you're interested.
People in Germany seem to love it.
People
so
in Germany
us?
like Real Love, but I don't know how they find it or how they could watch it.
But they've done it.
They do it.
And thank you for supporting us, Germany.
Thank you, Germany. You're so nice.
Yeah.
Even though we're so mean to you now.
Help us.
Yeah.
Pulling it back to the family thing, now that we've gone three layers deep.
Yeah.
Inception. The fact that his wife got as much talking and screen time in this movie, I think it's the first time I've seen her.
Yeah, usually they try to bury her in a movie, but...
They usually gets like a true real name. Cameo.
Yeah.
Yeah, right?
She has a real name in this movie.
But like it was like a real...
She had a character. Thing. Like, it wasn't a great character, but she had a character.
No, it was just like, well, this is a cast of like 100 people, like that, which is part of the joke, is that it just never ends. And I sort of like that tension. And I love when they're yelling in their room.
Yes, yes.
And everybody just ignores it.
I love when they like they leave the room and then they just start yelling at each, like Adam Sandler just starts yelling at her and then they come back and they're like, yeah, okay, so never.
I just like everybody, like everybody's like seems to be happy and like ignoring it. And I think it ruined it when one guy was like, are they gonna get divorced? And I'm like, no, it's not funny.
The joke isn't that. The joke is that the kids would love it if they got divorced because they just don't want to have to hear this bull crap anymore.
I like that they seem so like we go there and everybody's like smiling and feeding each other breakfast and stuff and like everybody was just so well adjusted to it, like, oh, that's just what they do.
I think it's more that they're trying to mask it. Because I don't know that you ever had to actively deal with it, but having been in a couple of broken houses, that's exactly what some people who are nicer about the situation want to do. Normally, if you are in a worse situation, a more realistic situation, it's everybody else is in a separate room while they take the house to do
I don't know, like, I grew up around old people, so, like... They weren't going to get divorced, so, like, that was never a fear that was going on, so it was just normal.
Yeah, well, speaking from a different perspective, like, it was frustrating for me, having heard all these things and having had to, you know, deal with some of those memories, and then see that it was just like, oh, yeah, we fight, but we love each other. Like, no, that is a poor situation in a family that should seek counseling for these scenarios if you have that much frustration. That's not to say that either of them is right in their situations because they both did something wrong and they both suck. But at least they could talk about it in a way that makes it so like, okay, yeah, we fight a lot, but at least we're going to counseling. Like, throw that as your little side thing in there, too.
I don't know. I feel... This like you say, Bob, right? we're sort of in a one-dimensional movie here, so...
Yeah, it's fair.
We're just sort of playing for laughs here, which brings me to a part where I sort of lost my mind.
Yeah.
Was with the bat subsection.
Oh, yeah. How could I forget about that?
It was thrown off as a joke, and then I can't believe that they followed up with it.
You're skipping so hard ahead of
my
notes.
I just... The bats are where my mind is at now because I just didn't know. I can't believe
the
we spent so much time with it.
Second Sandler movie in the entire movie. There are two Sandler jokes: the bats, and the grandmother portrait, which gets a reprisal at the very end of the movie.
Yeah,
when we have
well, you have Adam Sandler doing his Jill voice.
Yeah, yeah. Like I sometimes wonder whether or not this is just Adam Sandler's way of doing like very poor understanding of drag in his movies. Like, he can't be an actual drag queen and he can't actually do it without looking like an asshole, so he just plays it up for comedy in his movies.
Can I give you guys some Uncle Seymour trivia?
Yeah, okay.
I suppose.
Fine.
So, we'll start with in the film, Uncle Seymour lost both his legs to diabetes. Jim Barone, who plays Seymour, actually lost both of his legs to diabetes in 2012. In the film, it is mentioned that Seymour lost his legs due to diabetes. That is true of Jim... The legless... Okay, that's just...
Yes, it's a repetition. And also, it's like the one fact that we know about Uncle Seymour. So, I'm glad that we have
that. Hold up. So, I'm not going to read this.
Well, he was in the war.
Yeah.
No.
Uncle Seymour was in the war.
No.
He has an army. He has an army.
Jim Barone's character, Seymour, is 87 years old. In reality, Barone is only 57 years old. A mere 4 years and 87, and he's 57 years old in real life. He's only 4 years and 6 years older than Chris Rock and Adam Sandler, respectively. Oh.
Wow. Mm. He is a very haggard looking. They must have done some makeup on that guy.
I hope so.
It would be nice if they did.
Yeah.
That's the goal.
Yeah. No, I mean, I'm not surprised that they had an actor who had lost their legs And they probably wrote in that it was the diabetes thing because it gave a good way to kill him off easily in the story instead of like, oh, he has a whorehouse heart attack, which is the easy way to have done it considering all the...
I already miss him.
What?
I miss him.
You miss him?
Uncle Seymour.
Why, is he dead?
I love Uncle Seymour.
I mean, he's dead in the movie. He's not dead in real life.
He's dead. He's not Uncle Seymour in real life.
Well,
yeah, that's what he wants to
believe. He'll always be Uncle Seymour to me.
Anyway.
My favorite character.
Tell me all your notes.
Yeah, so top down, like we've already gone over like the title sequence, the first glance of both the characters and everything. Getting all the way down though, what is the cinematography? Like Long Island is actually painful, that painful. Having been to Long Island, I used to date a girl for about 2 and some odd years, and I'd have to travel all the way from Massachusetts down into Long Island. And it is that painfully like... sort of suburban, and everybody talks with the accent, and everybody seems to not understand certain social cues. You have to adapt to that culture. It's extremely frustrating, and they nailed it. So good there. But the best friend of the bride there is also so painful because she is what I'm to understand the kids refer to as a basic bitch. Which is to say, yeah, so to be considered basic is just to have no nuance to your personality. You are completely acclimated to these facets of culture that are just popular.
Basic
so,
bitch.
Yes, so, yeah, the good echo.
You just wanted to say it.
Yeah.
Yeah, no, it's work. Okay. It's fine.
What did I want to say?
Basic bitch.
Basic bitch.
All right, yep, we've all right,
so anyway, no, but like all the, hey, we could come out to Journey, but we're going to come out to this song instead. Yeah. We're going to do Dry Ice. Like, all these notes they're hitting are exactly real for somebody who has no personality or expansion beyond their local surroundings.
Didn't they even recognize that, like, oh, coming out to Journey, that's so overplayed?
Well, yeah, no, that's the joke. That's the crux of her character.
They really like to hit those. I mean, it's fine. I like it.
Yeah, but where was so the story? We didn't get the point of the story until, like, the last 15 minutes.
Bats.
Yeah. I wish the point was bats. Bats would have been a great way to, like, make a climax out of this movie. Nah, it was just played up for a simple joke to try and round out a.
It was a simple joke. It was like a 10-minute thing. Yeah, it just kept going.
The joke.
Well, I could believe that, but I mean, just to jump forward a little bit, the point of the movie didn't come up until like the last few minutes, where we decide to finally push Sandler's character to the brink, and he has to realize, oh, I'm doing all this stuff, and I'm being a tryhard because I don't want to lose my baby, like. Give us more hints to that. It doesn't really seem like it comes up all that much until the last moment where he has his little breakdown moment, and it feels like it's forced. I'm going to get into that in a bit, but like it just, the story up until that moment seems non-existent. It seems like everything is just almost more like a French film.
And here's the Stockholm Syndrome. I was going to say that. It kind of reminds me of Weekend. Remember?
I was going to say.
Remember Weekend? That's what it reminds me of.
Do you think that's why they chose the title?
Nope. Here's the Stockholm Syndrome coming out again. Just to have that revelation in an Adam Sandler movie is so like, wah, that you're just happy to have it. Yeah, you would want more hints in a real movie, but we're in an Adam Sandler movie, so like my bar is just lower, and I'm just happy to have it at all. That's me.
Okay, so other things. Yeah. I was not a fan. For those of you who have not listened to me on this podcast before, I tend to be the PC police. there's a good amount of benign racism with the Leonard and Jermaine joke, where we just keep referring to the fact that these two people that Sandler's character think are part of the groom side of the family, a black family. He just sees two people walking along the street, and because they happen to be black, hey, come on in, we've already got breakfast and everything going, and nobody questions it, and one of the guys in the groom's side of the family is just like, just go with it. So from that point on through the movie, they hang out and they just get to have free food.
Yeah, they're part of the crew.
But even then, like the joke has a culmination by the end where Chris Rock doesn't even know. Yeah. So now we play off. Oh no, it's totally not racist because Chris Rock didn't know that they're in the family.
Well, it is, but the joke, we're laughing at it. Like it, we're not behind it. We're laughing at Adam Sandler for being racist.
Oh well, I understand, and I'm the
well, because
PC
this
police.
Is this is what this is what I do with this is what I do with All in the Family too. Like we're not supporting these characters and their decisions. They're the butt of the joke.
Sure, I get that. I do. But that and the trigger jokes.
The trigger jokes.
So the kid of Adam Sandler's wife and the random dude who I'm sure is also related to the Sandler. they have an older son.
Yeah.
And that older son is not allowed anything because he just seems like he's gonna pop at any moment, and they just keep making all these jokes about how anything and everything can trigger him, and we don't really know, but just don't do anything.
Yeah, that didn't work, but I did like when he was stealing out of the wallet, and then Sandler goes in the door like 30 minutes later, and the guy's like, "Where's the money?" And like I like the director trying to sneak those little jokes in the background with him, but other than that, underutilized character.
Yeah, I think that if you're going to make those jokes, at least have a hard realization that, oh, he didn't have anything, he's just an asshole. Like, at least paint it out.
Yeah, that would have been better. I wanted to see more of the 12-year-old DJ. Like, I thought you could have got more bits out of this beat master at the age of 12.
Yeah, and I agree with that. But did anybody else notice that there's almost no real score or soundtrack until the end?
I loved it.
I don't know if it's because they were intentionally trying to keep anything out until the end, and they had the money to just splurge there and call.
Nah, they got Netflix money. I don't think they're worried about that.
Well,
I think it's a choice. I think a choice was they just sort of wanted this sort of French
Art Nouveau style,
new wave. Just like let it happen and just watch these people bottled neck in this place until it all explodes and let the pressure. And I think they don't do a good job of building up the pressure, but I'm just so happy to see somebody trying. Like they fail, but
it's better than to have not tried.
I've seen so many movies where he's just phoning it in, and it felt like most of the people in this movie were actually trying and having a good time. And it was just a nice thing to see.
Certainly. Third act finally points out the family man moral.
Yeah.
It's not until we get passed into the third act that we were like, oh, hey, Chris Rock doesn't really involve himself in his family, and so he's ostracized. But then we get to see that everybody loves Sandler's character, even though he's failing miserably at all his stuff, because, but he loves his family, so that's good, right? We already talked about Bats, but like...
Bats are so great.
Bats are one of the two...
Bats and Seymour. That's all I need from this movie.
I'm glad you like Seymour. I think the Seymour trampoline sequence is probably the culmination of his character. I don't like that he has like two or three takes where things just keep falling on his head. Like...
They fall on his head, but he's asleep. Like, he doesn't even notice.
No, but he...
When Sandler's carrying him around to the family, to like, give Uncle Seymour a kiss, and then the son's just like, I kissed him.
Yeah. I mean, like, to compare it to another Adam Sandler movie, I didn't mind having Colonel Sanders getting whacked in the head by the football, or getting tackled by Sandler.
Going back to Waterboys.
Yeah.
It's a good movie. This is a good movie.
That was a good Sandler movie.
I like that movie.
Yeah, no. But I didn't think I would. As a child... having seen Waterboy, one of the few good moments I had with my father was him letting us rewind the doi sound effect that Colonel Sanders makes when he gets hit in the head by the football thrown by what's his face there?
Medulla oblongata.
Yeah. Oblongata, not oblongata. Steve Blum is not in that movie, thank you very much. But
Steve Blum was in The Incredibles too. Just so you know.
Oh, that is good to hear. Yeah. I'm not surprised, though. Anyway, so I feel like they handled the physical comedy with that involving an elder person better than they did with, hey, let's just drop heavyweight things on this prone man.
That's fair. It was just part of like this whole house sort of falling apart. Like
sure.
Like at they put the dog up on the fridge, and then he just has to like live up there and stuff like that.
Yes, this was a groan-worthy movie, absolutely. Two meaningful moments for the couple that catalyze the movie. That's what we get. We get two meaningful moments between the actual bride and actual groom.
Yeah.
And everything else is centered around the fathers.
The fathers.
And we almost have no reason to have the bride and groom in the movie besides the fact
that the plot points.
Yes, that's it. And that.
What if we never saw them? Would that be? I think that'd be more interesting.
If you're going to do it all or nothing.
No, because the father has to have his revelation with the daughter. in the end.
But I wish then that we should have had more moments with the daughter and father together in the movie.
Yeah, you know, in a real that would make a movie successful.
Yeah, because at least she's trying to he's trying to make her tag along for all this stuff, so that way he can have more time with her. Or something.
Yeah, or or there could be more pushback from her where she's like, "It's fine the way it is," and he could be like, "No, it's gonna be amazing."
Yeah, they barely do that. It's like she kind of low.
Well, there's just not a lot of time. Like, it's a 2-hour movie, and
they try too much.
Exactly.
2-hour movie.
Exactly.
This movie's gonna be 90 minutes.
They jam in this movie full of stuff.
The lift bit was crap.
What?
So when they're doing the lifting of the two chairs during the party sequence, and we're having the Chris Rock and Adam Sandler. Oh yeah, we're having a talk up here. Like, okay, we got it. That's funny. Great, but. Then after that, we try to escalate things way too quickly. Okay, so we're lifting, and we're doing, 3 or 4 lifts. All right, this makes you guys look like jerks, but we're going to pass by it because it's a movie. Oh, okay, now one of them falls out underneath them. Oh, okay, because they fell out, now we have a fire. Great, we have a fire in this place, and that's forcing the dramatic moment to come to a head.
Yeah, it's our climax.
But literally, we have, this non-comedy... Until we have this moment where we have Adam Sandler be like, okay, I'm breaking down. I'm being real person for 5 seconds. Oh, this is supposed to be my drama moment. That'll get me some sort of Netflix award. And then we just go back to, party sequence.
Listen, he doesn't need an award for this movie. He's got plenty of award-based movies.
And I'm sorry for
fine.
That. I'm sorry
he's
for
not.
That.
He's just having his climax here.
Yeah, but does Adam Sandler enjoy trying to do his old bits still?
Yes.
I
guess.
It seems like he's trying to force the comedy that he had when he had his heyday, 1995 world tour stuff, into this movie.
Well, here's who I blame. Everybody who says, man, Adam Sandler movies used to be good. Why can't they be like that again?
They're exactly the same. We've changed. We've talked about this. We've changed.
He hasn't. That might be true.
He stayed the same. We just think we don't enjoy it, but...
He was always the constant.
Yes.
But the world moved on without him.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah, let's make Adam Sandler the tragic hero here.
That's what he needs.
He's never had that role before.
That would be interesting.
If you had an actual tragic story,
that would be interesting.
Can I suggest something?
Yeah.
Sure.
I want a spinoff of this movie with Sandler and Buscemi and Bats.
We don't need Bats.
We don't need the Bats again. But maybe what their younger years were like
with Bats.
John Voight already had a Bats movie. We're good.
No. They just talk about Bats. We don't need to have the Bats.
They're just super into Bats.
Yeah, they're researching Bats.
Okay.
Buscemi already showed that he has all the research necessary. If you're gonna do that, at least have Adam Sandler be the know nothing do well hero of the movie. But Rock's dead eyes stare at his daughter during the father-daughter dance that he does. He just, stares at her and looks beyond into the nothingness. And it's so eerie because, this is his moment of being a dad. I don't know if he's scared of dancing with his daughter or whatever, but it doesn't read like that. It just reads
I think it's bad acting.
Oh, it's super bad
acting. Chris Rock is just showing his edges.
I feel like it's more he is cringing, but he can't show that he's cringing, so it's all going up into his eyes while he's trying to have this really long hold on him dancing with his daughter. And then resolving Sandler's strained marriage as being like any other, as I mentioned already,
I think this strained marriage is just meant to be a joke. I don't think it's meant to for us to look too deep into.
No, but they try to resolve it with the Sandler and his wife dancing and talking about all this
stuff.
I think
it gets resolved when they do the bad things, when she's up and what are you doing up? She's like, I'm just always up. And they were like, well, let's go save the problem. And they work together as a team. I don't know.
Yeah.
Then they just dance at the end because...
Can we just talk about how bad the ADR in this movie is?
I mean, yeah.
I don't think it's a problem because I think if we notice it...
Well, we're film people that have to notice it.
I think we're more likely to notice it, but I watched this with a group of people and no one else seemed to, care about it.
Bury the lead. You watched this with other people?
I watched it with other people.
How many other people?
3 other people.
Give us their takes.
The guy who watched it, he didn't like it, but he doesn't like... He's, too cool for school, so he wasn't gonna like it.
Boring.
The women loved it. They loved Adam Sandler as a dad. They cried at the end.
They actually cried, cried.
They cried. They were moved.
Okay, here's a...
By the father-daughter dance.
So, on our last episode, we made Carrie watch the Meyerowitz stories, and she's also watched The Men, Women, and Children. Yeah. Those are two semi, like, serious
Those are ones. Very serious movies.
Well, like, but there's still comedy yeah. in Meyerowitz Stories with the beating of the car.
Yeah. yeah.
Do you think she would have liked this one?
No.
okay.
No, here. You've got to find one that's, like, 80 minutes long, and then she'll be okay with it.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Did anybody else feel like Rock was sort of like a tag-on star for
Yeah,
this
Rock's
movie?
Opened up the movie, and I'm like, okay, we're opening with Rock instead yeah. of Sandler. I like this. And then for 30 minutes, he was gone, and I...
You know, every time
when's
you
he coming back?
Rock, I always think of The Rock. I'm like, I wish The Rock was in this movie.
That would have been interesting, but no. Chris Rock, though,
yeah.
is in here for... We see him in the opening yeah. sequence, and just being like a lackluster doctor, but he's at least a doctor who's making bank. We see that he's living his bank yeah. life by having a woman that is not his wife yeah. inside a penthouse apartment.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, doesn't he... even acknowledges that. He's like, I've been, like, chasing ass for, like, the past, like, 30 years.
Yes,
yeah.
exactly. And the fact that, like, the bulk of the comedy that I found was enjoyable was all, like, I hate equating it to this, but it was like having the bits of... Who's the old guy in Community who I don't like?
Chevy Chase.
Yeah, Chevy Chase. It's like Chevy Chase-style slapstick
yeah.
being applied to Chris Rock.
I like Chevy Chase in Community. I just don't like him as a person.
That's what I mean. Okay. That's what I mean. But, yeah, no, but Chevy Chase's yeah. style of comedy was always that, like, bizarre series of events. Like, he's doing something and
his
stuff keeps happening to him. Yeah, his pratfalls. His like,
Gerald Ford bit that yeah. he's just been rolling over for decades.
Yeah, no, hold up.
But when applied to Chris Rock.
When he yeah. falls over, like, those drums,
yeah.
when he's, like, giving Britta the, like, therapy or whatever, right?
Okay, yeah, I remember that.
Yeah, I laugh, like, 3 minutes straight. He's just so good at it.
But can we just acknowledge, like, okay. the biggest point of comedy yeah. in this movie was Chris yeah. Rock for 5 minutes just being put into an uncomfortable situation, and that was the extent of Chris Rock's character in this movie. Like, he has a couple of moments when we have that, like, super cool, oh, I paid for this dinner, to show off that, oh, I have money but no connection to my family, so now I'm going to take a page from Sandler's book, so now I'm going to be a family man. Like, That's all we really yeah. get of Rock. Everything else is, like, the extended cast people interacting with Sandler. Yeah?
Well, he's also a catalyst, too. Most of the movie is Adam Sandler. He's trying to, you know, give his daughter the wedding he wants, but he's also trying to impress Chris Rock as well, so...
I don't even think it's that he's trying to impress Chris Rock. I think it's that he's trying to avoid Rock having to do anything with it, because he's proud.
Yeah. Yeah, it's but that's why he's like, he's got to work, he's working on the hotel and get everything set up and trying to keep him out of the house and stuff, so.
I think then that we could say that this is, in fact, Sandler's tragic hero movie, if we want to get into that. Because, I mean, think about it, he's fighting against yeah. a constant,
yeah.
he's got this ticking clock, and he's doing it all for the sake of his distant familial romance to his daughter,
mm-hmm.
you know, and he's failing. And it's not until he comes to the head and he acknowledges his faults that he's able to overcome eventually.
Yeah.
You know, because everything is left in his wake. Mm-hmm. Nothing works in his favor.
Yes. And I like that. I like it when he fails. I like when Adam Sandler fails and he goes on despite it.
I feel like if we looked at it less like a comedy and more like a tragic hero story,
yeah.
it becomes more palatable as a film.
Yeah.
Is that a fair statement?
I can go with that. I can go along with that.
What do you think of that, Joe?
Yeah, I agree.
Levy?
I just like when you're like, I like when Adam Sandler fails.
I like it. I like this character that tries his best and fails.
So and
I like that.
Can we guess what the budget is for this movie?
Do you have it? Does Netflix?
Netflix never releases a budget.
I didn't think so.
This movie kind of takes place in like three sets, right? Besides like the stuff.
Well, you're really paying for everybody to show up.
Yeah,
yeah, and if you're paying in the way that Sandler likes to do his stuff, it's... You get to be on set and have a sequence in the title.
Mm-hmm.
So, like, I feel...
I would say 60.
60 mil?
60 mil.
I was thinking 60 to 80, yep.
Yeah, I was in the same ballpark. I was actually thinking more like 50, 70. Because you have to pay for your two... You have to pay for your two people, and they were working off of a lot of goodwill from both towns in Long Island, as well as in Massachusetts.
Yeah, Adam Sandler does a lot of... film stuff up here, and there's some good tax breaks you can get up here as well.
Well, yeah, I know. Mm-hmm. We know.
Oh, we know.
Oh, we know.
Oh, we know.
But yeah, so, I mean, this is a modest budget movie for Netflix, where most of the money is probably going to your two stars, and that's fine. But I think that it was misnomered as a comedy. I think that if we played up a little bit more of the drama and broke it up with the comedy, it would be a stronger
film. I think if it felt more like Weekend,
yeah,
it would be fine.
I still need to actually sit down and watch Weekend. I watched a Welcome to the Basement review of Weekend.
What's that? Is it
a podcast? It's. I mean, I don't want to play up another person's show, but I absolutely will.
You should.
Blame Society Films is a great YouTube channel, and they have two major shows that I tend to follow. They have Beer and Board Games. Mm-hmm. Great show, stars Aaron Yanda and Matt Sloan with a rotating cast of people where they play various games and they drink various beers. And so they do a quick review of the beer, then they play the game. And because most of them are improv artists or comedians or whatever, they find a way to take even the most awful games like Candyland and turn them into very amusing experiences. They've had about 8 years running on that show and it's solid. A few years into that, though, Matt Sloan took one of his buddies, Craig, I'm forgetting his last name, and they were going to do 1 year of just watching a movie every weekend or two, and they would do it a review. Mm-hmm. So they would kind of Siskel Ebert it, but, you know, toss in their own zingers here and there. It's not riff tracks, it's true film review, and they do a great job talking about cinematography, framing, sound work, everything like that. And they do a variety of movies. It's not just, oh, hey, look, they're doing The Expendables. They've never done it. Don't worry about it. But they do things like Weekend. And it's a great way for you to learn about art film as much as, you know, your standard film out here in the States. And it's a good way, if you are a film buff, as I'm sure most people who are listening to this podcast are, to try and expand their reviewing skills as well as their filmography. So I would highly recommend that, and I highly recommend that Scahill and Joe take a good gander at that. Maybe I'll make you guys sit down and watch, because most of the episodes are like 20 minutes, so it's not going to kill you.
Mm-hmm. All right, any last looks before we close up?
I want a spinoff.
You want a
Bats? Just call
just
it Bats.
The musical.
No, oh, wait. He's never done a musical.
Oh, my God. That's happening. I guarantee it. Movie 3 out of the 4.
Mamma Mia 3.
No, Mamma Mia 1.5. The in-between story.
Do you think they'll get straight?
Yep.
Did she die in that movie? I don't know.
They implied that she died.
The way the second movie... I've only seen the trailers both these movies, but I've seen the trailer for the second movie like 100 times now, and I'm like, is she dead?
She died or she left, because Cher, her mother,
the grandmother,
is somehow still around. Isn't Cher only like a couple years older than Streep?
I don't care. I will never
watch
that. I'm
surprised Cher's still acting.
I'm not. God. Cher will do it until she dies.
I like almost everybody in those movies, but I'm not going to watch it. It does not...
Are we talking about Mamma Mia, yet another wedding movie, over the week of?
Keeping it on subject.
All right, Bobby, your last thoughts?
Honestly, I think you've turned me around on this movie. Not in that it is good,
yeah.
But I think that we've come to the revelation that this is a solid, tragic hero story that was poorly implemented, but was still done better than the average Sandler movie. Mm-hmm. I think this is a solid attempt at making an art-style movie using the Sandler tropes.
Yes, I liked seeing somebody put some effort into and some thought into this movie, and I have enjoyed that the Netflix movies have gotten better as each one has come out. And so I hope that the next four will sort of be on this next plateau of things trying, so hopefully they don't feel the need to rush them out
too
quickly.
Number 3 is going to be a musical. You're going to have to wait on it.
That's fine. I can wait. That'll be perfectly fine. And we'd like to thank our sponsors, the Honda CR-V. They're everywhere, so good luck trying to find a different car. And we'd like to thank Lev, the audio maven, who keeps the sounds flavin', and... That's a word. And, of course, we'd like to thank Bob for joining us. Bob, do you have a website you'd like to plug?
Well, actually, at this moment, my website is defunct because of a lot of life stuff.
Okay.
But if you are looking for me, I am a voice actor. I do have my media strewn about the internet. You can find some of my work as both actor and voice actor with Scahill and his production company, Quixotic United Productions. And if you would like to contact me, simply look me up. I am on LinkedIn as well as Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, and the like.
And then, of course, we'd like to thank Joe, the inventor of Hungarian dances. If you're dancing and you're in Hungary, Joe is the guy whose patent you're seeking.
Or if you're just hungry, you can find him, too. He'll be at the Waffle House.
The International House of Burgers.
The International House of Bitches.
IHOB. Times have changed. All right, thank you all for listening. I'm your host, Patrick Scale. Joe, say goodnight.
Good night.
Je n'entends pas nos deux voix sur cette terre.
My friend just put up a Happy Father's Day to all the dads out there, and he put up this picture of a wrestler having this kid in a headlock. This wrestler killed himself, killed his wife, and killed his son.
Been there.
Who's been there?
I've been there.
No, his name's Benoit.
Balls.
You know what has plagued me recently?
What has plagued you recently?
The Honda CR-V.
The Honda CR-V. Now, why has it plagued you?
Because I don't know if you've noticed, but they're everywhere.
Honda CR-V.
And I don't know why I've started to pay attention to it recently, but I can't get through a day without seeing 30 Honda CR-Vs on the road or parked on the side.
The life of a Lyft driver.
And sometimes they drive right next to each other. It's awful.
I haven't had that problem with the CR-V. What I have had that problem with is Chrysler 300s.
I don't think I've seen...
Like my own.
I don't think I've really seen those.
I'm going to look up these cars, so I don't know what you're talking about.
Joe, you drive a Honda.
Yeah, but what's a Chrysler 300?
I don't know. I don't think I've seen one of those.
Have you seen my silver car? Then you've seen a Chrysler 300.
It just looks like a silver car.
It's actually a silver car.
Yeah, it's like a boxy silver luxury sedan.
Yeah, no, it looks like the Simpsons sedan.
Yeah, kind of. Yeah, if you did it pink and a little longer in the front.
Yeah.
Because really, the pink car in the Simpsons is supposed to be more like a, I don't think you'd, not a hatchback, but a, what are those ones that normally have like the wood side? Like 1970s sort of thing.
I know exactly what you're talking about.
But, yeah, no. You know what, you're right. Mm-hmm. It is supposed to be, like, just a big pink sedan, but I feel like it's more like an old caddy.
Well, Homer has the sedan, and Marge has the hatchback or the station wagon.
That's
something.
Right.
With the panel.
Yeah, the station wagon. That's the one I was trying to get out.
Yeah, oh, man.
Is this the pre-show banter?
I just, like, it's starting to irk me that every time I see one, because I can't go 5 minutes without seeing one. They're just everywhere.
And well, they
I was
are
wondering
a solid
if you had noticed this in your travels.
Every time
the overabundance of the Honda CR-V.
Every time I park at like somewhere, I always see my exact car, the Honda Accord, like in blue, same color blue. And like, I'm like, don't park next to me. I'm gonna get confused. And I don't. Like, it wouldn't open up if I used my key, like thing, right?
Yeah. I don't know.
More often see the Honda Odyssey or the Honda Pilot. The Pilot is the one that I see the most.
I see not the Pilot the most, although I have seen
a
lot of Pilots.
We've established that you don't see the Pilot the most as you're having this problem with your CR-V. Even though the CR-V is a solid...
I'm always grateful when I see a Pilot because I'm like, oh, thank God, a break from the CR-V. Because I saw the H and I'm like, oh, it better not be.
Wow, solid car talk from guys who are around 30.
who don't care about cars or less.
We're the new car talk, right? Those guys retired, so now it's
they
us.
They did. Oh, man, my wife used to love listening to that years ago when it was on the regular, but now they just do repeats on...
Makes sense.
On
Yeah.
Yeah, it's so weird to hear repeats of a car show doing talk show stuff with call-ins from, like, 5 years ago or more.
Well, you know... You can still learn a lot about fixing your car.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah, I'm just going to pay somebody. I don't have time for that. I don't want to break my car.
Yeah, me too.
Okay.
Right around that.